I was exultant, unaware of what was to follow. Though at every stage of my life I had faced problems, the ordeal that I had to confront alone during my elder daughter's marriage is of a kind that cannot be described in words. I pray to Sri Guru Raja every day that such adversity should not befall others. When the matrimonial alliance for my elder daughter Vedika was in the offing, the bridegroom's parents and relatives came to Chennai to see the bride on 21-2008. They had seen her in a TV program earlier in which she had rendered songs and so were familiar with her face. Since both the families and the couple mutually agreed, the bridegroom's party belonging to E Road proposed the betrothal to be held at Sri Raghavendra Swami Brindavana on the bank of the Kaveri River on 11-2-2008. It was acceptable to us since I had fixed the program for the release of part 7 of Sri Raghavendra Mahimai on 7-2-2008 at the same venue, even before the date for the Nishchedartham had been finalized. Sri N. Ramani of E Road had been requesting me for more than a year to have the function for the release of part 7 to be held at that Brindavana. 7 speakers, including me, delivered talks on the occasion of the book release there. Sri A. M. Rajagopalan, the astrological luminary, expressed his heartfelt desire that he should be born as a Madhva if he had another human birth. Spurred by his intense bhakti towards the Madhva saints and the Haridasas of the sect, Sri Velayudan of Vijaya Publications, Coimbatore, Sri Makuteshwaran, the graphologist who has figured in part 5, Dr. Bala Ramani, a poet and director of Doordarshan, Chennai, Sri K. Sashi, the Layachitra artist contributing his line drawings for Sri Raghavendra Mahimai, and Sri Hanumadasa, whose experiences have been covered in part 5, conveyed their message of good wishes on the stage. And in this gala event, it was a pleasure to have had also the company of the bridegroom's family members. Amongst the auspicious dates considered for the marriage, it was concluded that 22-6-2008 was the best one from all perspectives, and accordingly it was chosen for the Shubha Muhurtam. My brother-in-law Sri Raghavendran and his wife, after casting the net wide even up to Chengalpet, found out only Pon Maligai in Trustpuram, Kodambakkam, being available for celebrating the marriage there on the date fixed by us. So the required advance amount was paid for that Kalyana Mantapam, and Sri Raghavendran brought for our viewing some photographs of the marriage hall taken by him in his camera. As the hall was not that big, it was decided by us after consultation with the bridegroom's party about its suitability that the marriage invitations could be distributed in such a manner as to accommodate the invitees in groups for the different events connected with the celebration. By the grace of Sri Harivayu Guru, the betrothal function went off very well at the same venue where part 7 of my book, Sri Raghavendra Mahimai, had been released, formalizing the proposal of wedlock of my daughter Sau Vedika and Chiranjeevi M. Suresh, son of Sri R. Murali and Srimati Usha of E Road. I then returned to Chennai, thoughtful every moment about the mercy of Sri Guru Raja. The following day, my wife and I visited the marriage hall. We found out that the place has its office room in the ground floor, and adjacent to it are the kitchen and dining space. Climbing a flight of stairs, the marriage hall can be entered, a space that should accommodate about 500 invitees. The balcony of the hall can accommodate about 150 persons to view the proceedings in the hall. On top of it are some rooms and terrace space. A small Vinayaka temple has to be passed by to reach the office room from outside. It's accessible from inside through a flight of stairs from the marriage hall. Arrangements were made with Sri Jay Raghavendra Catering for food supply and Sri Ramakrishnachar for the religious rituals, and Sri Chakrapani, the caterer, raised the pertinent point that my estimation of guests to be at around 650 to 700 for each session of the marriage appeared to be an underestimation. I said, more number can of course be invited, but paucity of space is the constraint. It was then decided that for the three events, Janavasam, Muhurtam and reception, different invitations could be printed and distributed amongst the distinctive groups identified by us. After the invitations were ready, they were kept in puja at various temples, sacred places before distribution. I could not invite many VIPs I had acquaintance with, mainly for the reason that the marriage hall was inadequate to accommodate a larger number. On 26-2008 evening, a group of 30 persons and the bride Saubhagyavati Vedika left triplicate for the marriage hall. The same night, the bridegroom's party left E Road by rail for Chennai, and in the early hours of 21-6-2008, we had gone to the central station to welcome them formally. After their alighting from the train, we were all walking along the platform when we saw on another platform the Mantralaya Peetadhipati Sri Sushimendra Tirtha and his disciples moving towards the exit way. I had a distant darshan of him, mentally praying for his grace for the successful completion of everything that I had arranged for, with the fond expectation that the Swami would be at the marriage hall the next day, affording the opportunity for his darshan there. The Pontiff was to participate in an event in Chennai only on 26-6-2008. But when there was a change in his program and he was to be in town on 22-6-2008, I had contacted the Mantralaya Math authorities and got their approval for the Swami's presence at the marriage hall on 22-6-2008. The Raghavendra Mrittika Brindavana, located in Alagirinagar East Street, Vadapalani, is close by the marriage hall. Singapore Jayachandran was the driving force behind its establishment. A fruit of his soulful devotion towards Sri Raghavendra and a spontaneous response of that devotee to the mysterious ways in which the saint of Mantralaya had extended his grace to him on various occasions. It is a Brindavana installed in June 2005 by the holy hands of Sri Sushimendra Tirtha, the Peetadhipati of Sri Raghavendra Math, which he had proclaimed he would be doing himself at the time of its Bhumi Puja. It was during that Pratishtapana that Sri Raghavendra Mahimai Part 6 had been released by the Swami. Since the Swami had not visited the Brindavana after that auspicious occasion, it had been planned that after his engagement at the Nanganallur Mutt, he should visit the marriage hall and thereafter the Vadapalani Mutt en route to Pondicherry. It was therefore thought that we could all have darshan of him at the marriage hall, and so we reached the Kalyana Mandapa straight from the railway station. It was indeed a divine blessing that I should have received the first prasad by post on 21-6-2008 from the Anjaneya temple near the tank in Kumbakonam, installed there by Sri Vijayendra Tirtha. In part 4 of Sri Raghavendra Mahimai, I have narrated the incident of how this metamorphosed Anjaneya from a different form earlier had come to be installed there by Sri Vijayendra Tirtha. In the evening, Sri AMR and his family attended the Janavasa and blessed the couple, extending their honor to me too. At one point of time, The number present at the Kalyana Mandapam was very large, and in the dining hall, invitees were being entertained in groups in quick succession. The marriage hall and balcony were fully occupied with streams of invitees moving about those places continuously. We had estimated an attendance of about 600, but the actual number exceeded more than twice that figure. Thanks to Sri Jayaraghavendra Catering, they managed things efficiently, preparing food continuously for all the guests, filling the dining hall in unending batches during that evening function. The Muhurtam was to commence only at 9:30 a.m. next morning, and so the local people had gone home for the night. I then went to the floor where the bridegroom's party had been accommodated and inquired of their comforts. The bridegroom's father, Sri R. Murali, asked me then whether all arrangements had been made for the formal registration of the marriage. And I told him that the officials concerned will come to the marriage hall itself the next day. I had made prior arrangements for it, paying the additional levy for the registration of the marriage at the Kalyanam Mandapam itself on the Muhurtam day, which was a Sunday and a holiday. I informed Sri Murali that if the departmental officials came at 10:30 a.m., it should be all right to get the signatures of the married couple, since the ritualistic Mangalya Dharanam would have been over by then, adding that they had indicated they would be coming first to our place before going to two other marriages away from the area. It was raining heavily that night, and being exhausted thoroughly, I had sound sleep, undisturbed by the noise of the downpour outside. Added to that was the contentment at heart that the Janavasa had gone off very well, and so the Muhurtam could also be managed equally efficiently, quite unawares that the next day I would have to be facing an ordeal all by myself and wriggling like a worm without any peace of mind for even a moment.